Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Well, hello, Knife Junkies, and welcome to the midweek supplemental episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast. It's episode number 107. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco. Thanks for joining us.
The Knife Junkie Podcast is the place for knife newbies and knife junkies to learn all about knives and knife collecting. And as we seem to have, Bob, every Wednesday, every midweek show, it's always a full show. And this week is no different. Want to talk about some knives and things that we're going to be auctioning off, as well as talk about Knife Rights Ultimate Steel with a lot of great stuff in that. Knife Life News, stories to talk about, product drops, those kind of things. Four stories we want to talk about. State of the collection, several things that you want to, my favorite word, bloviate about this week. And then we've got a new segment that we're going to be doing this week called Dad's Story. You want to give me a little tease about that?
Yeah, well, my mom and dad have always spoiled themselves. After they got us educated and there was money left over, they would travel. And they've been to a lot of great places and a lot of weird and exotic places, places where you're kind of like, why are you going there for vacation? But on all of those trips, they started the tradition way back when I was little, and I made sure they carried it on. Even to this day, as an old man, I'm still making them do this. But when they go to some far-flung location, I always ask them to get me a knife, bring back a knife or a sword. But over the years, I've sort of stipulated that it's got to be a real working knife, a knife from the culture, not just something that they pick up at a tourist shop. So in doing so, I think my folks, especially my dad, found a challenge in going and finding these knives for me. You know, getting something authentic, going off the beaten path to find something authentic. So he's got some pretty cool stories to tell. And today, I wanted to have him tell the story of the most recent thing he got me a few years back. A Filipino bolo that he got for me in the Philippines. So he's going to tell me that story.
All right. So that should be interesting to hear. And not that you're a challenging son by any means necessary. A, you want them to bring back a knife or a sword in their luggage. Okay, challenge one. But then you have stipulations about what kind of gift you want them to give you. So I would be interested to talk to Dad about that angle.
Well, you know what? I say, like, if they're going to end up in international prison for this, it should be over something good and legit.
Not some gas station knife from a foreign country.
Exactly. And it's not always so easy to get out of countries with knives. He's got another story. He'll tell another time about that.
All right. Well, talking about knives, that's what we do here on the Knife Junkie Podcast. It was really cool when we had the live Knife Town Hall a week or two ago on April 18th, Saturday. Unexpectedly, I know you were surprised when the announcements were made by a couple of guests. Folks are giving you some knives and things to auction off.
Yeah, completely unsolicited. Our first guest of the day, actually, Stu of Stone and Steel, knife purveyors up in New England. When he was talking to us, he pulled up this beautiful black CQC, super CQC7, which is an extra large CQC7 from Emerson, held it up, pulled it slowly by the camera, and said, "I'm giving this to you." And, you know, of course, I couldn't say thank you. I had to say on behalf of, Knife Rights, I thank you, because we had to auction it off. This, to me, receiving a gift is nice, but on that special day, the town hall, it was all about bringing people together and knife people together, but also to support the community. I figured it was hard to say, but I figured maybe we'll auction this off and it won't go into my permanent collection. But so we're
unless you buy it,
unless I buy it, right? No takers, so. So yeah, we're going to auction off a Super CQC7 from Emerson that has not arrived yet. Just yesterday, arriving in the mail, I received from the Terzuolas, a copy of Bob Terzuola's new release. Well, his old book is out again with a whole new chapter, and it's, oh my God, I was looking very carefully through the book. I didn't break the binding or dog ear any pages, but I was looking through the book, and it is beautiful. And hey, if you want to learn how to make a knife like Bob Terzuola, you have to check out this book. It is really cool. And plus, it has a bunch of beautiful examples of his knives in it. which is a treat. He also sent to auction off. Now, Bob Terzuola stipulated that we auction off this stuff, and I myself chose Knife Rights as the beneficiary. It just makes sense. He also sent one of his titanium bottle cap lifters, which is really cool. If you've ever seen his logo, it's kind of like a traditional Japanese dragon head logo, kind of looks like. Well, he has these really cool bottle cap openers that are milled very detailed out of titanium of that logo. So he sent one of those to auction off. And then thirdly, he sent off the mass drop. It was mass drop when this knife came out, but you know them as drop now. And Terzuola / Wee Knife collaboration knife. And it is a beautiful S35VN drop point Bob Terzuola looking tactical folder. It's really cool. It's about a 3 1/4 inch blade, G10 sculpted titanium handle. It is gorgeous. So he sent us those three things very generously. We're going to auction them off. We're going to figure out. We were just talking about how you and I, Jim, have to do a little bit more research, but we're going to figure out how to throw the most equitable and
fairest.
Fairest. That's where we hear equitable all the time at work. Let's say fairest.
Right. The most fair way, yeah.
The most fair and dynamic way to auction these things off. We're going to wait till we get the Super CQ7.
Get everything in it, yeah.
We'll do it all together.
Yeah, there may be a little bit of technology needs or something on our end, maybe on the website or something. But stay tuned to the podcast. Stay tuned to Thursday Night Live, Thursday Night Knives. We'll have details and everything coming up about the auction and how it's going to go. And again, all the proceeds from these great donations are going to Knife Rights. And Bob, as I'm blabbering, I was just thinking if anybody has anything else they want to get in on the auction, we might have some time to take some more stuff that is going to benefit Knife Rights. So, you know, if anybody has anything, I might even have one of the knives and the knife haul I bought that maybe I can throw in the auction. So,
yeah, that would actually... That'd be a great idea.
Yeah.
So, I mean, while we're talking about it, let's just talk about Knife Rights for a second. It's an organization headed up by Doug Ritter, who's been a guest on this show a couple times, but you also know him as the designer of the Ritter Griptilian and now the Ritter Hogue RSK MK1. Such an awesome knife. But Doug has a background in all sorts of different kind of safety and adventure kind of stuff. He was the first person to put together a survival kit for helicopters flying around out west for desert survival. Very interesting dude. Anyway, he's been heading up Knife Rights for the past about 10 years, and it's him and a small cadre of legal experts going state by state and revising these antiquated knife laws that came out of Reconstruction right after the Civil War to stop non-whites from carrying around weapons or switchblade laws that came about during the 50s when West Side Story and Rebel Without a Cause came out. You know, these are 50-year-old or older laws that are just ridiculous and stop people like you and me from really enjoying our hobby. And he's been and it's not just a hobby. It's a working tool for a lot of people. Think about everyone in New York City who needs a knife to do their job. And there are a lot of working people in New York City who have to sweat walking around with a knife. It's ridiculous. Anyway, all of this is to say every year Knife Rights does a big giant fundraising campaign called The Ultimate Steal. And it's just opened up again for this year. And when you go to kniferights.org and check out this contest, it's unreal. It's not a contest. It's a fundraising drive. But for the first couple of months, whoever donates is really like has a very good chance of getting a knife for free. And they start with SOGs, the new SOG XRs and Wee Knives and Spider Co's for some of the donations. And they go all the way up into these incredible custom knives that you can win, if you give $1,200 or this kind of thing. So anyway, definitely go check out the Ultimate Steal over at Knife Rights. A couple years back, started giving to Knife Rights. Well, it was last year. This show started giving to Knife Rights and kind of wondered why it had taken me so long to start doing it. So anyway, right. Check it out. They're really, really helping us out. They've changed so many laws since we've started doing this podcast a year and a half ago.
Well, and you have lots of different levels to donate, starting at $20. That'll get you in one entry, $40, two entries, If you wanted to give $100, that gets you 9 entries, 4 entries for free, and the free $55 Song Terminus XR. I think there are supply limits, so it depends on how many donations at those levels there are. But again, at that $100 level and going up, you start getting different knives and those kind of things that are included with your donation that you get. So great opportunity to raise some money and a great opportunity to support a great cause. So check out KnifeRights.org, the Ultimate Steel 2020.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie podcast. And now here's the Knife Junkie with the Knife Life News.
So every week on the supplemental show, we talk about new knife drops, things that pop out, things that I see on knife news that are exciting. And I have grown a soft spot, as have you, Jim. I think actually you're the one who got me to grow the soft spot, but for these sort of crowdfunded
projects.
Thank you, Jim. These crowdfunded projects coming out by small or up-and-coming companies or companies that need a leg up in the knife world itself. And we have another good one. It's from a Canadian craftsperson named Mark Liss. Origin Goods is the name of his company. And his Kickstarter is for a new knife called the Ailman. The Ailman, which, well, I'm an ailman from time to time. It's someone who likes to open up a bottle of ale with their knife.
I was hoping that's where you were going with that.
Or maybe it's German. Alemann. I don't know. But anyway, it's a little Kiridashi. It's a pocket Kiridashi. Kiridashi is a traditional, small, triangular-shaped Japanese utility knife. And this is a little 2-inch bladed, beautifully sculpted little Kiridashi that has a bottle opening notch on the pommel, if you can call it a pommel, you know, the tail end of the knife, and a beautiful leather slip that it slips into. You could throw it right in your front pocket or back pocket, and it's like a little bartender's friend. You can use that, use the blade for pretty much anything, but think of it. You use it to cut the foil on that wine bottle, and then you open up the bottle, or you know, you get the beer, you flip it around, use the back to open up the bottle with the notch. So anyway, it's a $10.95 little blade, and you can get it at two different tiers. One of them is the more expensive is more sculpted and has a lanyard bead and a couple of more little perks like that. But the real USP of this knife is that it is traditionally a Kiridashi is chisel ground. This one is V ground, which is something Westerners might be a little more used to. I don't know if that's true or not with all of the chisel ground knives out there, but it's an interesting change for a Kiridashi. I personally love chisel grinds because of how screaming crazy sharp they get, but I could see how on a small utility knife like this, you might want to go with that V grind just for a little bit more robustness. So anyway, check out this Origin Goods crowdfunded Kiridashi little front pocket EDC with the beautiful leather slip. Their Kickstarter might be rounding up right about now, but end of April, and definitely go check them out. Origin Goods.
Mm-hmm. All right. So check that out quickly if you have any desire to get one of those little knives. And I don't know, as you were describing it, it sounds kind of like something right up my alley that I might be interested in. So.
Yeah. And think of this, too, with the beautiful, you can tell just from looking at it that the leather is really nice. That sits in your front pocket for a year. Think of how beautifully patinaed that leather is going to be and how nicely rounded. All right.
So either front left pocket or front right pocket, depending on the Knife Junkie's carrying criteria, which we have discussed here on the Knife Junkie podcast before.
Yeah.
Some other things we have talked about before, Real Steel and also Poltergeist Works. So yes. Next up in Knife Life News.
Jacob of Poltergeist Works, another Polish company, by the way, has been, I'm only going to say his first name because every time I practice his last name and I say what I think it's like, when we go on air, I just butcher it. So I'm going to say Jacob from Poltergeist Works. He's been supplying some really great designs to Real Steel for folders over the last, I'd say, 3 years or so, with his signature, some of his signature design cues, like those giant chainring bolt-looking things at the front and back of the handle, which I think just looks great. His lines in general are very recognizable, and he has a thriving custom knife business. Terra Fanatic, a guy on YouTube and Instagram, used to collect his knives, if you want to go back and check out some of those. Anyway, he's come out with something unique to him because it's a fixed blade, and it's an outdoor blade, and it's small and convex ground. So all of those things are kind of unique. Yeah, exactly. Jacob is known for his folders, okay? And Bushcraft knives are known for having a little bit more size than 3 inches. And Real Steel, I don't think, has ever made a convex ground blade. And I can't remember what the third thing is, or the fourth thing is. But anyway, it's called the CVX-80. It looks really cool. It's got that great signature look of his. It's a constant belly over 3 inches of convexed. What is it? What is the blade steel? I don't know what the blade steel is. Sorry. But it just looks like it's going to be an incredible cutter for such a small knife. Plus, you have the incredible ergonomics of Poltergeist Works. So just look like a neat and unique thing.
Mm-hmm. Moving on, we won't dwell too much on any of these because we got a lot of stuff to cover in the show still to come. Of course, the State of Collection, where Bob's going to be talking about three different items, and we still get to hear a story about a new, or not a new, but an old knife, or how that came to be in Bob's collection from his dad. So that's still to come. Next up, a name that we don't talk about much here on the Knife Podcast, but a name that pretty much everybody knows, Victorinox Knives.
Yeah. Okay, so I wanted to bring this up because I saw that they have two new... So every year they come out with a new color for their Alox. That's their aluminum-handled models. And this year, they've announced that it's aquamarine, which is kind of exciting on a personal note because it just so happens that my two lovely daughters right now happen to be obsessed with aquamarine. I can't tell if they love the color or just like saying aquamarine. So I might be getting a couple of these in the future. But they put them on the, what is it, the Pioneer and the Cadet. So you can look for the new teal slash aquamarine Pioneer and Cadet coming from Victorinox. But another thing that's kind of cool is their... Hunter model, their big pro hunter model. Now, this is a nearly 4-inch bladed locking knife. It's something that does not look like a Victorinox too much, and it's definitely not your traditional slip joint multi-tool version, but it's a folding, generously bellied locking blade that they've had out for a few years. Actually, you can see it if you look carefully in the movie The Martian when he's cutting up potatoes. You can see him using an orange-handled version of this knife.
I love that movie, yeah.
It's such a good movie. And you know what? I guess that's the knife you take to Mars with you. But the Pro Hunter...
It worked for him.
It did work for him. He didn't need anything more expensive. He didn't need a hinderer up there. They're coming out with that Hunter Pro in Damasteel, which is cool. Now, Damasteel is a Swedish company that makes Damasticene steels for modern knives. And I think it's really cool there that Victorinox is taking this model that's kind of flown under the radar, but is from what I can tell, a pretty great model, and they're dressing it up a little bit with this with Damasteel. So check it out. It might be worth a view, and definitely if you're a Victorinox or Swiss Army knife lover, you have to check this thing out. The Hunter Pro Damasteel.
Well, one other story Bob wants to cover in Knife Life News. Yep. Seems like we are almost always talking about Artisan Cutlery. They're a name you talk about a lot.
Yeah, they are coming up. They are coming up. And actually, I have a new CJRB that I'm going to be talking about in a minute. That's Artisan Cutlery's budget line. But I just wanted to mention another through line in this show is we keep mentioning modern slip joints that are coming out from these modern companies. So I just wanted to get this out there that Artisan Cutlery is using, is putting out a new knife. It's a slip joint, and it's by up and coming designer Dylan Mallery. Dylan did a knife that has been, it's called the Biome, by the way. This new slip joint is called the Biome. Dylan, you know him for the Archaeo, which is a sleek, long, lean, stabby-looking knife that it's a frame lock folder that they came out with over this past year. And I believe they also came out with a budget version. Anyway, this new Biome is kind of falling in line with all these new modern slip joints. It's just got modern materials, G10, but it's got the standard back spring, and it's got 12C28N blade steel, and it's just looking like a nice little inexpensive slip joint, but with modern materials that you might, you know, that you might want. The funny thing is it's got a nail neck, and a nail neck implies that it's got a bit of a pull, like most traditional knives. You know, you put your nail in the nick, and then you have to tug. But this knife, in an odd move, has a ball bearing pivot. So it's a slip joint with a ball bearing pivot. Does anyone have any feelings about this? Is that weird? I don't know. Is Artisan only really good at ball bearing pivots, so that's what they did with this? Or did they find that it had a unique advantage and therefore made that design choice? So just an interesting little thing, the biome, Dylan Mallery design coming up by Artisan Cutlery. A slip joint in the traditional sense in terms of construction, except with a ball bearing pivot. What's the point? I'm not quite sure. And I'm not trying to be a snot about it. Really, let me know why you would want to have a ball bearing pivot on a slip joint.
Interesting. Yeah, I'd love to get some feedback if you have any thoughts about that or any reasoning. Call the listener line and let us know. We'd love to get your opinion and play it on an upcoming episode so that you can share your knowledge, not only with us, but other folks listening. 724-466-4487. 724-466-4487.
And now that we're caught up with Knife Life News, let's hear more of the Knife Junkie podcast.
All right, back on episode number 107 of the Knife Junkie podcast. And Bob, I think you have three things you want to address in the state of the collection. So I know you mentioned CJRB, and I know we've talked about that on Thursday Night Knives before, about what that stands for, and I cannot remember. But you wanted to talk about one of your new CJRBs.
Yeah, that's right. I remember we were talking about it, and I had no idea. And Women Carry Knives looked it up and wrote it in and told us, and I forgot it. And it's just so funny because women are detail-oriented, and I'm not surprised that our only female viewer, or probably one of our only female viewers, was the one who looked into the details. So thank you for that. CJRB, not sure what it stands for, but it is their budget line for Artisan Cutlery. A relatively new within the past few years knife company from China that is really knocking it out of the park with both design and execution. About a year ago, I mentioned I got the Kinetic tool from them. That's their switchblade butterfly knife multi-tool. Well, I picked up the CJRB Talla. It is the design that really strikes my fancy the most from them. It's a beautiful Wharncliff style blade. Because I wanted to compare it to the Civivi. I told you recently that I felt a little bit out of the loop because I haven't been checking out Civivis and some of these new budget lines from these high-end Chinese makers. And so I'm kind of getting one of each just to kind of check them out. And this CJRB is awesome. I love it. I got to say, I love the way it feels. I'll do a full review on it. But just right off the bat, I have to say, feels like a great knife, and it is also seems like quite a tactical knife. Like you could really use this thing if you were I'll get into that later, but it's ergonomically, it's very much set up for tactical use, right? I think, even though it's in a cheerful blue.
Oh, I like blue. Yeah. That's my criteria for
Yeah. Right. Oh, it's blue. Yeah. Bring it.
Sign me up.
Another thing I wanted to mention is the DLT exclusive XM-18 No-choil Wharncliff. That's right, the DLT exclusive XM-18 No-choil Wharncliff by Hinderer.
That's a mouthful.
Hinderer knives. Okay, we all know I love Hinderer knives, and I love Wharncliffs, and I love my XM-24 Wharncliff. But I really had no intention of ever trying to hunt down a 3.5-inch Wharncliff. They're a bit of a unicorn out there as it is, and I already have the larger size, which is what I prefer. But when DLT Trading came out with an exclusive no-choil Wharncliff with the tri-way pivot, I had to get it because it has those three qualities that it is a 3.5-inch Wharncliff. It has no-choil, which if I could have all my Wharncliffs no-choil, I would. I mean, if I could have all my Hinderers no-choil, I would. And then it's the tri-way pivot, and I have never used the tri-way pivot. I never even held one. So I figured I had to get this, and I'm glad I did. And I have to say, I love this tri-way with the bearings. I thought when I received it, I was going to immediately swap onto bronze, to the bronze washers, because we all know how much more sturdy it is. That was sort of facetious. But this is such a great and stout setup, and the action is so amazing. I'm going to leave it on the bearings for a while. So I'm going to do a video of this and do some comparison. I know I keep saying I'm going to, but I got a video. I got a video for a bunch of knives coming up. So,
all right. Well, you know, in your defense, coronavirus has, canceled school. Well, not canceled school, but everybody's not going to school. But parents are being forced to homeschool their kids. You're a little busy with that. But
I'm a geometry teacher now. I mean, algebra.
Oh, either way. But I did want to mention the Knife Junkie's YouTube channel, TheKnifeJunkie.com/YouTube, TheKnifeJunkie.com/YouTube. That's where you can find these knife review videos as well as the podcast and Thursday Night Knives. We put both of those shows up on YouTube. That way, if you find it easier to listen, that way you can. But maybe more videos back in the future after Bob gets out of his school teacher routine.
Yeah. You know what I don't understand is letters in math. What's that all about? I thought letters were in writing and numbers were in math. But anyway, We'll talk about that another time. Well, or maybe we just won't.
Let's don't.
Before I wrap up the state of the collection, I wanted to, because we're going to hear a story about how my dad got a Filipino bolo from me from a special Marine down there in the Philippines. Well, yesterday I had a lot of chores to do in the back nine, which is only a back quarter or half. But I went into the back nine to do some chores, and I brought my Luzon, my Cold Steel XL Luzon, which is one of their few liner locks and one of the few knives they use make their blades with 8CR13 MOV. And I have allowed the knife world to convince me that 8CR13 MOV is like warm butter. And I got to say, it isn't. I went out there and did a substantial amount of delimming and devining of this. We have this giant white pine, which I don't like white pines, and it's right next door to us in our neighbor's yard, but it leans into ours, and it's threatening to crush our house at every moment, and it's covered with vines, so I go out there and devine every once in a while. And this 8CR13 on the Cold Steel Luzon XL just cruised through all this material. I was good half hour of work on wood and, you know, live wood, but vines and stuff like that, brought it back in, still shaving sharp. So don't get too wrapped around the axle about 8CR13 MOV, especially if Cold Steel's giving it to you. You know their heat treat is going to rock. So the Luzon, it's cool. It's not just a pretty face.
Well, and even though the, what'd you say, 8CR13?
MOV.
MOV. Even though that's a hell of a hard thing to remember, I mean, why would you come up with that for a name for steel? I do not know, but anyway. Yeah, speaking of yard work, I know this past weekend I was out cutting the grass, edging, trimming, raking, doing all kind of stuff. Everybody in the neighborhood was out, so it was like a normal Saturday, even though we're still going on this coronavirus. Obviously, we weren't right next door to, I mean, right beside each other, you know, but it was a first nice warm weekend, not raining, so everybody was out cutting the grass that had grown, you know, 2 feet. So
yeah, exactly. Starting to feel normal again. Huh?
That's right. Hopefully, we'll get there soon.
Yeah.
All right. You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast, episode number 107, and now on to a special, I don't know if it's going to be every time or too much regularly, but occasionally we'll get to hear some inside scoop from the Knife Junkie's dad about special knives in the Knife Junkie's collection and how they came to be. And we heard at the beginning of the show that Bob's a very picky gift getter, and that he gives criteria to his parents for what they can give him when they go on their travels. So what's this story we're going to hear from your dad, Bob?
Oh God, Jim, you paint me as such a villain. I'm just saying, if you're going to get pinched for a knife, make it a good one.
Such a diva.
Well, my dad is very into history, and he's been doing a lot of these tours over the past 10 or 15 years where he goes to the South Pacific and checks out old battles. Places where battles from World War II, the Pacific Theater battles took place. And so he spent a bit of time in the Philippines. And of course, I was like, you're going to the Philippines? Get me a knife or sword. But make sure it doesn't say Philippines on it, you know? Make sure it's like, gritty. The real deal. And he said, okay, if I can, I will. And so he did.
And he did. Well, he did, and why don't we just let him tell the story in his words?
You have been all around the world, you and Mom, and you have been on some trips recently, solo, when you were checking out the South Pacific, looking at different battlegrounds and battle areas from World War II, and you went to the Philippines. I want you to tell me and tell everybody about the story about getting this cool bolo.
How much narrative do you want, Bob? I can go on here for a while. You want the story of you going to the Philippines?
No. I don't want all that, Dad. Just tell me the story about buying the knife. Where were you when you got this bolo, and who'd you get it from?
Okay. I got the bolo from a Filipino ranger towards the end of our trip, after we'd been to the Cabanatuan POW camp. We went to a ongoing Filipino ranger station. And this is, you know, real life type stuff. It's not historical content or anything. And we had a ranger as our guide for the trip. And he was a tough, wiry little dude who I would definitely want and would now want to meet in a dark alley sometime. He looked exactly the way we should look. And he's all dressed up in camo and so on and so forth. And part of the demonstration was using his bolo knife to start a fire, just with a, on a log, on a piece of, what's the word?
Flint?
Locking on the wood.
Well, he just used the bolo to start a fire.
Yeah, he used the bolo to start a fire. And, it was truly amazing the way he just took some shavings out of bamboo. That's the word I was looking for. Bamboo poles, and he started fire with it. And afterwards, he took us around the camp a little bit. And at the end, I noticed that he had about three or four of these bolo knives lined up on the platform that he was using. And being very bold on occasion, I said, sir, my son not only loves Filipino martial arts, but collects knives and has a lot of knives and so on and so forth. Would you be willing to sell them? And obviously, that's why he had them up there, because he wanted to sell them. And I got it for you. I took a look at all of them, and I settled on yours for whatever reason. I can't remember exactly what that reason. They were all slightly different, but that's the story of that part of it.
Well, the Filipino Rangers and the Special Marines down there still use their bolos not only to get through the jungle and all the close vegetation, but they also use them as weapons on occasion. A cool thing about this bolo you got me is that in sort of traditional fashion, it looks as if it was put together in haste, like impending battle on the way, impending fight. And like a lot of the Filipino bolos and swords that are not meant to be wall hangers, they're really meant to be used. They're made from leaf springs. They have, like the handle on this one is a little bit longer than the tang of the blade. And they didn't try and finish it in a way to fake it. It's just a tool, period.
Right. It's a tool, and it's not necessarily for sale. It's for use. And but they saw a number of people there who would be willing to buy one, I being one of them, and so they sold me one.
So, Dad, did they do any cutting demonstrations at all?
Yeah, they did. Again, on bamboo, and quite sharp.
Yeah, it's sharp, and those guys really know how to cut. What can I say?
Yeah.
They know their angles. Well, Dad, I look forward to hearing more stories. Just a teaser, there's a story that you're going to tell sometime in the future where you played chess with the guy forging the knife that is now hanging on my wall.
But we'll
talk about that another time. Okay. That is an extra cool story. And I also want to talk about how you barely made it out of, I don't remember which stand it was.
Turkmenistan.
Yeah.
Turkmenistan. And that's part and parcel of the, of that knife story.
Of that knife. Okay. So that knife has a really nice story.
has multiple facets.
Yeah, exactly. All harrowing. Well, Dad, thank you so much for coming on and telling this little story. Look forward to hearing more.
Okay, Bob. Okay, I'll be here.
So I'm really glad that story has finally made it out. Just
because it's cool. And when he told me, I was so excited. But it's hard for me to retell it every time. And of course, I didn't experience it. So it's just cool to see that one of these wall hangers that you see every time you see Thursday Night Knives, it's right over my right shoulder. You know, that's a bolo that was made in the jungles of the Philippines, you know, and kind of hastily, which is kind of neat, and put together and used and then sold to my dad. So it's a cool thing.
Yeah, that is neat. Now, every time on Thursday Night Knives, as I'm watching, I'm going to sit there and look for it and, you know, and it'd be interesting. It's always interesting to have stories with the knives, as you say, or your swords or whatever. As you've talked about several times on the podcast, every knife to you has a story. You can kind of remember when you got it or where you were when you got it or what year, what time frame, what was going on in your life. So that's kind of a neat way to personalize and make it more meaningful.
I think so, too. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, folks, we have gone a little longer than normal, but hopefully you have enjoyed it and thought it was worthwhile. We would love to get your feedback. Please call the listener line at 724-466-4487, 724-466-4487. Also, please, if you're listening slash watching on YouTube, please give us a thumbs up or a like. Whatever podcast player app you're listening to, please also do the same. We would love to get some positive feedback. Also, give us a review or a rating. We would love some constructive criticism that way as well. And if you have enjoyed and found this podcast or Thursday Night Knives helpful, please share it with a friend. So for Bob, the Knife Junkie DeMarco, I'm Jim Person saying thanks so much for joining us on episode number 107 of the Knife Junkie Podcast.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487 and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.